Shalom, I'm Messianic Rabbi Zev Porat, and welcome to Biblical Hebrew Foundation. We are living in prophetic and exciting times. There's never been a generation closer to the second coming of Jesus Yeshua than this generation. We're not setting any dates, but we know that the time is near. Satan knows that the time is near. Satan knows that his days are numbered. That's why there's so much spiritual warfare. As the gospel escalates to a new level and souls are being saved, so does sin escalate to a high level, because the time is near. Revelation chapter 12, verse 12. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short. That's why when we see what's going on, we understand the prophetic realm. We understand the more the world is turning upside down, the closer we are to the final victory, to consummate the marriage as the eternal and victorious bride of Yeshua, Jesus. Yeshua, Jesus, is the high priest. And through him, all those under the blood of Yeshua, all those who call on Yeshua, Jesus, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as Savior, as Lord of their life, repent and turn to him. Believe that he died on the tree on the cross for our sins. He rose on the third day, and by his blood we have full redemption of sins. Through him we become priests, ambassadors for the kingdom. And until that time, until we consummate the marriage, there is going to be spiritual warfare. Exodus chapter 19, verse 6. And unto me you shall be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Those are the words that you are to speak to the Israelites. And all those under the blood of Yeshua Jesus get grafted in to the olive tree, spiritually Israel, and we become, Ephesians 2:15, the one new man, and thus we become priests. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you are to declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into the wonderful light. This is speaking to all those under the blood of Yeshua Jesus, all those that are grafted into the olive tree, into spiritually Israel, and become one in Yeshua. And Jews who are grafted back into the olive tree. Romans 11:23, Numbers chapter 4, verse 23, and I'm paraphrasing, says that the priests were to go into the service. And the word service there is like the service in English, the military. So we can see that priests would go in to the tabernacle and they were like soldiers. And we, through Messiah Yeshua, we put on our priestly garments in the spiritual realm, we go into the service also, and that's called spiritual warfare. And that's why it's important that we understand what is the desire of the enemy, what was his desire and what is his desire, so we can put on our priestly garments and fight against spiritual warfare through Messiah Yeshua. So today we're going to examine scripture, what is Satan's greatest desire? So we can understand how to walk as a priest, because he's our enemy. He's trying to stop us. He knows that his days are numbered. And this will help us to understand what the warfare is all about. And there are three questions that I'm going to address and answer. Number one, so what was Satan's desire before the fall? Isaiah 14 will answer that for us. Very important, when we read Isaiah chapter 14, we're going to see that there are five statements that Satan said, I will. All these statements, it's going to shock you. All these statements have to do with being lifted up or going up, being seen, being high. Let's start with Isaiah 14, verse 12. How you have fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. Now, that's an inaccurate translation, because in Hebrew it says, Shachar ben Halel, son of Dan, worship leader. Oh, how you have fallen from heaven, son of Dan, worship leader. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. This is what he said in his heart. These are his heart's desires. And let's read again these five I will statements. I will ascend. Notice the word ascend. Go up into heaven. Second I will statement. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. And we know that exalt means being lifted up in Hebrew. My throne, you put a throne up high. Above, again up, the stars of God. Third I will statement. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation. And a mount refers to the highest point of a mountain, the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. North is always up on a map. The fourth I will statement, verse 14, I will ascend above the heights. Notice three words, ascend above the heights of the clouds. And watch what he decides to use in number five. I will be like the Most High. He doesn't say the Most Holy. He says the Most High. He wants to be lifted up. Now let's see God's response. Isaiah 14, verse 15. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. So we have a description here in the scripture of what Satan's greatest desire was and still is. Five statements, and the word will in Hebrew always means a desire. So when it says, I will, it's saying in Hebrew, I desire, I desire. If someone asks you, will you come? And you say, yes, I will. You're actually saying, yes, I desire to come. God's will is God's desire. Satan's will is his desire. So we have here five statements from Lucifer saying, this is what I will, this is what I desire. I want to be lifted up. I want to be high. I want to be exalted. I want to be worshiped. And then he even says it very clearly. I want to be like God. I want people to worship me. Actually, it's the nature that all men are born into. Some theologians will say we're born with an Adamic nature, which means a nature like Adam's, a fallen sin nature. We live in a fallen world. And that's true. But Adam or Eve were not the original sinners. Satan was. Satan is the original sinner. And that nature that Adam and Eve fell into is look at me. I want to be seen. I want to be lifted up. I want to be exalted. I want people to worship me. I want people to pay attention to me. Before we come to Yeshua, Jesus, as Lord and Savior, the most important person in our life is us. I'm going to say it again. Before a person comes to Yeshua, Jesus, as Lord and Savior, the most important person in their life is themselves. And sometimes that nature is still inside of us. And I can take a very simple example to prove it. Who is the first person you look for in a group picture? And if you don't look good, the whole picture is bad. That's a bad picture. Don't use it. Delete that picture. And that's what we're born with. But through the blood of Yeshua, Jesus, the focus goes off from us and onto him. He is first in our life. He is Lord and Savior. When we get born again, our desire is to follow Yeshua. Now we know that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one. But he sets an example for us. The Bible says in John chapter 13, verse 15, I have set before you an example. And I'm paraphrasing. But we see something. Yeshua is always turning the attention off of himself. He's always turning the attention or to the Father or to the Holy Spirit. Every time they pay attention to Yeshua, this is what he does. No, the Father sent me. No, I came to do the will of the Father. I do what the Father says. I do what the Father does. And when the Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit, he's going to do this. He's going to do that. And you need to know that the Holy Spirit's coming. So he always takes the focus off of himself and puts it on the Father, puts it on the Holy Spirit. Yes, he is the Holy Spirit. He is the Father. But he's setting an example. The focus is not on himself. It's on God. It's on the Father. It's on the Holy Spirit. And our focus is on Yeshua. And here's what the Bible says, and I'm paraphrasing. When the Holy Spirit comes, he talks about Yeshua, Jesus. I'm sure if we can listen to one of the conversations between the Father, Son, Holy Spirit that are one, it would be something like this. You're so wonderful. No, you're so wonderful. You're so great. No, you're so great. The more we become like Yeshua, the more we don't want to focus the attention on us, but put the intention on him. This is Satan's desire way before we were even here. His desire was to be worshipped, to be lifted up. We started with verse 12, but I want to back up to Isaiah chapter 14, verse 11. Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, and the sound of your stringed instruments. This is very, very important. I'm going to read it again. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 11. Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, and the sound of your stringed instruments. And we're going to come back to this verse again later on, but you need to see it in the Bible. This Bible verse is talking to Lucifer, talking to the devil, and it says that he has stringed instruments. That is very, very important. So just remember that Satan has stringed instruments. Now let me tell you something else about Isaiah 14. This was a prophecy actually given to the king of Babylon. But we know that God is addressing Lucifer. But it was given to a man, but it was speaking to the spirit behind the man. Now this is common in Bible language. This is a pattern in Bible actually, in many places. And I'll give you one example out of many. And it's a Bible verse that all of you will recognize. When Yeshua was walking on this earth, he turned around and he said something to a man, but he was actually addressing the spirit behind the man. He turned to Peter and he said, "Get behind me, Satan." So this is normal in scripture. And you can look at Isaiah chapter 14, 4, and it tells you that. You will take up this proverb against the king of Babylon. So this is speaking to the king of Babylon, but it's addressing Lucifer. Now here is a prophecy given to the king of Tyre, but it's very clear that we can see that it's talking to Lucifer, to Satan. Let's have a look at Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 11. "Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre, and say to him, Thus says the Lord God, you were the seal of perfection." That's pretty amazing to say this to a king. You were the seal of perfection. He's not talking to the king, he's talking to Satan. It's very important to realize you were, this is past tense, you were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. And we're going to see why Lucifer, Satan, was created perfect in beauty. And it has to do with his responsibility that he had in heaven. Ezekiel 28 verse 13, "You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering." This is why he was perfect in beauty. He was covered with precious stones. And then it gives us a list of them. The sardis, the topaz, and the diamond. The beryl, the onyx, and jasper. Sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. "The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created." I'm going to come back to that statement. Very, very important. Verse 14. "You are the anointed cherub who covers." Now what's a cherub? A cherub is an angel. So we can see here, this is not the king of Tyre. He's talking to Lucifer, who we know by scripture is a fallen angel. "You are the anointed, you covered, you ruled. You are one of the three archangels in heaven that ruled over a third of the angels in heaven. When Lucifer fell, when Satan fell, a third of the angels, those under his authority, those who followed him, fell with him, called today the demons. "I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of fiery stones." Ezekiel 28 verse 15 now. "You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created, till iniquity was found in you." Verse 16. "By the abundance of your trading, you became filled with violence within, and you sinned. Therefore, I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O covering cherub or ruling angel, from the midst of the fiery stones." Let's go back and have a look at the last part of verse 13. It says, "The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes were prepared for you on the day you were created." Let me explain this. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes. This word timbrels, it means, in Hebrew especially, a percussion instrument. What would be a close word today for a timbrel? A tambourine. The workmanship of your tambourines, percussion instruments, and your pipes. Let me tell you what this word pipes in Hebrew means. It means wind instrument. Your instruments that you blow through to make a sound. Now combine this with Isaiah 14 and the sound of your stringed instruments. And here he says, "When you were created, I created in you timbrels, percussion instruments, and wind instruments, pipes." All instruments fall in one of these three categories. Any instrument is either string instruments, a percussion instrument, or a wind instrument. All instruments, all. Lucifer was created with instruments in him, the Bible says. Why? It's very simple. Because he was a worship leader in heaven. That's why it says in Isaiah 14, it doesn't say morning star. It says in Isaiah 14, Shachal ben Halel, son of Dan, worship leader. There are three archangels in the Bible, or three ruling angels. rule, or have authority. And they're named, all three are named in the Bible. Gabriel, Michael, and Lucifer. Those are the three named in the Bible. And I want you to think about something very, very important. Every time you get together, these are three components in any worship service. Worship, prayer, and the Word. Anytime you see the angel Gabriel, he's announcing the Word of the Lord. He brought the Word of the Lord to Mary, the mother of Yeshua, Miriam in Hebrew. He brought the Word to Zacharias, the father of Yohanan HaMatbid, John the Baptist. So Gabriel brings the Word of the Lord. When you see the angel Michael, he's answering prayer. Daniel chapter 10, when the angels are trying to get an answer to Daniel in prayer, we see the ruling angel, Michael, has to come and help him because he's the one that rules over prayer. Of course, he's given the authority from Messiah Yeshua, the King of Kings. So you got Gabriel ruling over the Word, Michael ruling over prayer, and Lucifer ruled, past tense, over worship. And then it says, you became filled, and I'm paraphrasing, from violence within by your trading. And I want to focus on that word trading in Hebrew. Very, very important. Some translations use the word merchandising. Now let me tell you what this word means in the Hebrew. It comes from the root word mischal, but it also could mean sachal. And I'll give you an example. Let's say someone owns a suit store, and he is the owner of the suit store. And let's say somebody works for that owner and selling his suits. And someone comes in and they want to buy a suit. And you say, let's say for sake of example, the suit is $300. The salesman receives the $300 and he takes $200 and puts it in the cash register. And he takes $100 and puts it in his pocket. That in Hebrew is called sachar mischal. That's merchandising. In the context in the Bible, that's what it means. So you're giving me something. So what it's saying is a person is receiving something that doesn't belong to him, but it's passing through his hands to the rightful owner. But instead, that person takes some for himself. Here's what it is. Satan was leading all of heaven in worship, and the worship was supposed to pass through him to the rightful owner, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Yeshua Jesus. And one day, as he was leading worship in heaven, he said, and I'm paraphrasing, I'll take some of that. And God said, you're out. Yeshua said it this way, I saw Satan falling like lightning from heaven. And let me tell you something, he didn't fall because God was insecure about him taking some of his worship. He immediately left heaven because God is the only one worthy to be worshiped. And Satan stole something that didn't belong to him. And his greatest desire, Satan, has always been to be worshiped. So that's point number one. Here's point number two. What is Satan's desire? During this earthly time when we're on the earth, what's his desire? Let me read you the scripture, Matthew chapter 4, verse 8. Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. So we know that he's taking Yeshua up here. Verse 9, and he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Now I'm telling you based on the Bible that Satan's greatest desire is to be worshiped. And while he's tempting Yeshua, Jesus, he tries to get the Son of God, Yeshua, to worship him. And it's interesting to see the language that he uses. Because he says, if you will fall down and worship me. He doesn't just say if you worship, he says if you will fall down and worship. What he's really saying is, if you'll express it. I want you to express it. I want you to understand something. Worship is always expressed. Worship is love being expressed. Now, I remember we had a brother, loves the Lord, but usually in worship, he just pretty much sits down calm, never expresses too much the worship. And I asked him, why is it you're always sitting over there calm? And he said, well, that's my character. And I said, okay. He said, I love the Lord, but that's my character. Then we went to an outreach to a Maccabi Tel Aviv basketball game. We had some tickets to go in and then get some relationships with the people over there and then talk to them. There's a lot of people that go to those Maccabi Tel Aviv European basketball games. And suddenly this brother was jumping and clapping and dancing. And I said, wow, he suddenly had a different character. It was like a miracle. This brother that's sitting in the congregation so calm was now dancing and clapping in a basketball game. His personality totally changed. If he can get excited about a bunch of men running after a ball, then you can get excited by being redeemed from hell to eternal life. We need to be excited when we worship Yeshua. Satan doesn't want us to express our love to Yeshua HaMashiach in worship. Revelation chapter 13, verse 4. So they worshiped the dragon and gave authority to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him? Listen to these statements. Who is like the beast? And who is able to make war with him? You know why that jumps out at me? Because that's in Exodus chapter 15. When the children of Israel crossed the Red Sea, the Bible says that Miriam led them in a worship song. The horse and the rider he is thrown in the sea. And I'm paraphrasing. And she leads all of Israel in this victorious song. And in that song, and I'm paraphrasing, there are two lines that go like this. Who is like our God and who is able to make war with him? This is called Shir Moshe, the song of Moses. And in Revelation, the Bible says that we're going to sing that song in heaven, those under the blood of the Lamb. Who is like our God and who is able to make war with him? And we're living in prophetic times right now where many are singing that to Satan. Who is like the beast and who is able to make war with him? Can you see the spiritual warfare here? There's always the counterfeit in the Bible, and that counterfeit is Satan. Now here's what's going to happen. And we're going to answer the question, and I'm paraphrasing. Revelation 17, verse 13. These are of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. Revelation 17, verse 14. These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. For he is Lord of lords and King of kings. So here's what's going to happen. I want to give you a picture of what's going to happen. One day, Yeshua is going to be sitting on his throne. And they're going to be singing, who is like the beast and who's going to be able to make war with him? And Yeshua, and I'm just giving you an illustration here, is going to ask Gabriel, what did they say? And Gabriel, he's been waiting for this day for a long time. They said, who's like the beast and who's able to make war with him? That's what they said, Lord. And Yeshua is going to call him Gabe because they're close. Get me my sword. And John describes what happens next. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. He that sat upon him is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and wages war, and I'm paraphrasing. And his eyes are a flame of fire. And on his heads are many crowns. He's clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. And he has a name written which no man knows but he. And the armies, clothed in fine linen white, that's the priest, that's us, followed him on white horses. And out of his might and out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that he should smite the nations. So he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And his name is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That is who is able to make war against the beast. Hallelujah. I just want to bring out that it says that Satan was covered with precious stones. You know what precious stones do? They reflect light. Why would Lucifer be covered with every precious stone? He was supposed to reflect the light of God to all of heaven. He was the worship leader, Shachar ben Halel. But here's what's so amazing. Lucifer was covered with every precious stone. Revelation 21 verse 2 says, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, Yerushalayim HaKadosha, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. How is she dressed, the bride? She's dressed in white. But Isaiah 61 verse 10, and it says, the bride adorns herself with jewels. In Hebrew, it says, the rocks and the jewels. She's covered. Lucifer was created with instruments. Did you know you were created with instruments? Lucifer was created with strings, wings, and percussion instruments. Do you know that you have strings in your throat? We call them cords, vocal cords. Do you know how those strings make a sound, wind, and it passes over them? And you were created with percussion instruments. Lucifer was covered with every precious stone. The bride covered with every precious stone. Lucifer had instruments created in his body. You have instruments created in your body. Satan probably asked God, who's going to be your new worship leader now? And God took some dust and blew some wind. And out of the dust came man. And he said, there's my new worship leader. And furthermore, that dirt is going to crush your head. I will show you how great I am. I'll show you my power. And I'll do it through a piece of dirt. Pretty amazing if you think about it. But something happened. When God blew in the dirt became a living soul that would live forever. And then the dirt decided to follow Satan. So God became dirt and gave up his spirit, died to redeem the living souls that he created. And so what is Satan doing right now? He's trying to do everything he can to stop you. from worshiping God because he knows that his time is near. Let's continue to walk in his light as ambassadors, as priests for the kingdom. Preach the gospel, bring the gospel back to Jerusalem, and go home. Thank you for joining me. Until next time, I'm Messianic Rabbi Zev Porat, sending you blessings from Israel in the mighty name of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Al Yehuda, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the great I Am, Jesus Yeshua, Amen. Who is able to make war against the beast? Jesus Yeshua, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Amen.